فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحوم كالطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon all conditions. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every one of us and to grant us goodness and to let us witness the beautiful month of Ramadan that is at our doorstep. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, how many of you have made use of sales in the stores? Chain store, and sometimes there is a sale. And sometimes we actually do silly things to buy what we want at a very low price. How many of you have benefited from sales? Put up your hands, please. Almost all of us. Okay, mashallah. Besides those who don't go shopping from this side, mashallah. Okay. So you know what it feels like when you have just hit a beautiful bargain. You know what it feels like. So imagine you're in the store, superstore, and whatever you want and need so desperately for the house, they're selling you 10 for the price of one. Clear and safe. 10 for the price of one. I know what I would do. Whether my family or my wife is happy with me or not, I would actually sometimes overbuy. Because I know, gosh, I got this at a bargain. I only needed 5, but I got 10 because it was 10 for the price of 1. Whether I give the other 5 away or keep them or store them or stock them or whatever is irrelevant. The fact is, I took it. Put it into my trolley. And what happens? As I'm going down the trolley, the aisle, I see something else. Ooh, put that as well. This is a bargain. I'm never going to get it at this price. When it comes to shopping, at times we actually go and buy things we don't even need just because it's cheap. I'm not going to get this again at this price. I'd rather take it. The same applies to holidays, right? This is the Easter break. I wasn't even expecting many people here, subhanAllah. To me, everyone's supposed to have been on holiday, but mashallah, may Allah bless you guys, reward you. May Allah give you light upon light. Say ameen. Mashallah. Ameen. So, wow, you guys are here. Alhamdulillah. That's impressive. Because if you had a bargain, holiday, where's your favorite destination? Tell me, favorite holiday destination. What's it? Anyway, Turkey? Turkey, yeah? Maybe you watch a little bit too much of Ertugrul, right? Peshawar. Oh, mashallah, Peshawar, but there's no Ertugrul there. Unless you're just going to watch it on Netflix or something. You know. May Allah make it easy. If you had a bargain and they offered you a holiday to Peshawar or to Turkey or wherever else, where would you like to go?
Zimbabwe,
trust me. You can fly free of charge, bro. Mashallah. May Allah bless you. You can come and stay around mines, mashallah. Hardly ever there anyway. So, it's so exciting. We are so happy. Whoa, I'm going to Malaysia because you know what? We got tickets at 50 quid. Whoa. We've got a package at 100 quid a person. We're all going. We're going to spend the week there, Langkawi, and we're going to come back. Right? Subhanallah, we are happy because there was a bargain. What we needed, what we wanted, and sometimes that which we weren't even searching for is actually or was on a sale such that we made sure we got it. Okay, okay, okay. Now, Allah does the same for us so often. Every year, Allah gives us a season where what we desperately need is being given to us, not 10 for the price of one, but 70 for the price of one, going up to 700 for the price of one, and going beyond that. And you know what? Alhamdulillah, we know it's the month of Ramadan. Deeds, the value of this deed is multiplied in the month of Ramadan, which means you're doing a little and you're getting a reward that's huge. Subhanallah. If someone told you, listen, your working hours are cut. You've been working from 8 to 5. You can only work from 11 to 2. And I'm going to give you 10 times the salary. What are you going to say? Subhanallah. You know what? I'll only work from 12 to 12:30 and you can cut that salary back to 5 times. Yeah? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant those without jobs, jobs. Say ameen. Allahu Akbar. Ameen. That could have just been an ameen that solved people's problems. Do you know that? So my brothers and sisters, Allah gives us a beautiful season and He tells us it's unlike Hajj. Hajj is once a lifetime. The reward of it is رَجَعَكَ يَوْمِ وَلَدَتْهُ أُمُّهُ. A person comes back from Hajj as clean as the day they were born. In fact, there is something amazing about Hajj. When we say as clean as the day they were born, we're only talking of it from one aspect. Did you know that? What's the aspect? The day I was born, I didn't have good deeds, I didn't have bad deeds. When I come back from Hajj, my bad deeds are wiped out, but the good is still there. You see, it's better than the day you were born. So when the hadith speaks about you come back as clean as the day you were born, it's talking of the sin side of it. Not the good deeds are also wiped out. No, no. That's the mercy of Allah. When you get close to Allah, He carries your good. He says, I wipe everything out. When the everything according to Allah is not the good, but the bad. Just the bad. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept Hajj once in a lifetime.
وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا.
And it is owed to Allah that everyone who is able and capable to fulfill the Hajj fulfills it at least once in their life, right? As a result, you get cleansed. When do you go for Hajj? You go for Hajj when you decide or when Allah decides? When Allah decides. So I just want to clarify something. You cannot say, I can afford it, I can manage it, but I'm not ready for it. I tell you why. Allah makes you ready by giving you the wealth and the ability and capacity when He knows you need now to go. You might die. You might not see the next year, the following year. That's why the ulama, all of them, have said from the beginning, if Hajj is farad on you and you haven't gone, you're living in a sin. Subhanallah. You're sinful in that aspect of it. You're delaying something you're supposed to be doing. Yes, if you didn't make it through quotas, because some countries, very difficult, you can't make it. I know in the Southeast Asian countries, some people wait for 20 years to be accredited. Did you hear what I said? How many years do you wait for here? Is there any wait? No, if you want to go, you go, right? Trust me, even in South Africa, people are waiting 3, 4, 5 years. They apply and who knows, some of them die before they end up going. Some of them get married and they had only applied for themselves. So now they delay it a little bit. And some of them applied together, but they're divorced. So now they don't want to go anymore together. Whoa, see? This is what's happening. You are so fortunate. You have it that you can go almost instantly. But you know what? We're lazy. Remember, Allah knows why He made you able. At a certain point, He wants you to go. He wants you to go. So go. But going back to the month of Ramadan, it's every year. I promise you, if you look at it, Allah says,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ.
Subhanallah, Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah says, oh you who believe, fasting has been prescribed upon you, just like it was upon those before you, in order that you achieve a better relationship with Allah. That's called taqwa. Taqwa is to develop a relationship with Allah. Some people say, the fear of Allah, fear of Allah. I want to tell you something interesting about the fear of Allah. When we say khawf, when we speak about the fear, it is not that we are scared of the Most Merciful, but we're fearing displeasing the one whom we love the most. You know when you're deeply in love with someone, you fear hurting them. Am I right? You don't even want to say a word that they might misunderstand. You start clarifying yourself and justifying what you said. You know what? No, 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 no. I didn't mean it this way. I didn't mean it that way. Because you love them. With Allah, it's the love that should drive us. And we're actually fearing displeasing Allah because we don't want Him to be upset with us. So it's a fear driven by love. I hope you understand what we're saying. I love Allah. So that's the reason why I don't want to upset Him. I don't want to anger Him. I don't want to earn His wrath in any way. So yes, there is an element of fear, but it's a very detailed interpretation where it's fear that stems from the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't want to be cast into hellfire by the most merciful. He won't do it. He won't do it if you've given Him a single excuse not to. So give Him that excuse. We've heard about men and women who've achieved paradise through one deed they've done. Something that was your struggle. And you did it solely for the pleasure of the Almighty. Subhanallah. Your struggle. Solely for the pleasure of the Almighty. Allah knows about it. He knows how difficult that little thing was for you in your personal life. Due to the surroundings and whatever else there may have been. In terms of circumstances. And for that He might say, listen, I love this one deed so much. That's it. Close everything else. Just go to paradise. May Allah grant us these good deeds. That's why we say, don't judge people. You don't know. You don't know what they're going through. We're all trying to get closer to Allah. And the speed differs. And what we've changed is different. You know, I remember speaking to some young boys who were into, we used to call it souping up the cars. You know, when you soup up your motor vehicle. What do you call it here? When you, like, you know, put magrums and you put like a big exhaust at the back and you try and get some, what do you call it here?
Ricing.
Say it again?
Ricing
up your car. Is that what they say? I think the guys are guilty here. It's not a bad thing. It's just, it depends how obsessed you are with it. But anyway, so I remember these young people and one of the guys says, listen, I can only afford to change these magrums. You know, the wheels, right? The other guy says, no, I'm going to start with the exhaust. The other guy says, I'm going to make sure I've got the sound in there that moves the whole street when I'm going down. I don't know why the guys like to do that anyway. But if it's Ramadan and you're going to, let the Quran blast, perhaps it might be a better idea not to install it, but it was installed for the wrong reason, but we're going to make you change that intention, inshallah, right? So, subhanAllah, it's amazing. I remember when I was young, ours wasn't so loud. It was just the normal average Toyota one. But I used to put Ali Jabir, you know, Ali Abdullah Jabir, the reciter. I used to put him loud. And I remember, stopping at this traffic light. And I see someone saying, I love your music. And I'm like, this is Quran, But anyway, but it's so soothing. Wallahi, it's so soothing. The Quran has a spirituality that's unique. It's amazing. It's something that you cannot describe. You need to feel it. Even those who disbelieve or those who may not believe in Islam, they might be believing in something else. They will still be impacted by the Quran. So much so that even the animals and the birds and the other creatures of the Almighty are impacted by the words of Allah. But I tell you, the point I was raising is, each one changes what he can or what she can, depending on their capacity and depending on the circumstances and depending on what's easy for them to do. You might have had a bargain to change one thing, you changed it. There might be a wealthy guy who's changed everything and you know what? That whole car is just going to be smashed about a mile down the road. May Allah protect us. Ameen. Can happen. And there could be another guy who couldn't afford to change anything yet, but his car takes him to his destination. Right? And then you got another one who sells the car and buys an aircraft. MashaAllah. Allah bless us all. The point I'm raising is we all are with Allah in a relationship similar to that. I've changed one thing in my life that I could for the sake of Allah. You changed perhaps a different thing for the sake of Allah. Maybe you found it more difficult. Perhaps I might have struggled in one thing. Then I changed another thing when I managed to do it. Then a third thing. Hence the question one of the sisters asked a little bit earlier about, am I hypocritical if I just were to wear the hijab in Ramadan and then no. And you know, I told you, it's very difficult to answer that because we've got an issue. What is it? We know what is our duty, right? But we also know the reality on the ground and what it is. And we know each one has their struggles, just like I have mine. And we want to encourage you. So we will tell you, my sister, when you walked into the masjid, what did you do to yourself? You will say, well, I tried to cover myself as best as possible. Why? Because you know what? This was the house of Allah. I know I've got a duty, but when I came to the house of Allah, I felt more obliged to be more appropriately dressed in a way that perhaps I will not displease Allah in His own house. Surely that's recommended. I mean, surely it's commendable to say the least. Commendable, right? Because you walked in and you felt for a moment, hey, you know what? This is the house of Allah. When you go to Makkah, for example, you won't just walk around in your whatever you might have been if you weren't properly dressed. Just an example. The guys who smoke, they won't just light a cigarette and start smoking in the middle of nowhere. No, they won't. It's a sign of iman when you say, hey, hang on, this is the house of Allah, throw this thing away. Sometimes when you see a religious person, it happens that, you know, you tend to throw away the cigarette. I know of people who do that. I know of some people, they have the scarf on their shoulders, and suddenly you see a guy with a beard and you put the scarf up. I used to wonder when I was in India, and it used to happen a lot. And I used to say, am I the only man here? And I realized, yes, I am. Subhanallah. When I say, yes, I am, I mean, you know what, you got a beard, you actually, somehow, something happens to them, you know? And they just feel, no, gosh. But I want to tell you, it's from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ regarding the angels. And the hadith says, the angels are affected by what a normal pious human being would be affected by in terms of negativity when a person does something that is not upon the level of morality or values that Islam teaches. Did you hear what I just said? So the angels, they get affected by it. إِنَّ الْمَلَائِكَةَ لَتَتَأَذَّى, meaning these angels, they feel this adha, this discomfort, this pain. When I say pain, I mean it's like a grief at what is done in terms of that which would affect a normal pious human being. You know, they probably wouldn't judge, but they would feel at least to say a little prayer in their hearts if they had a golden heart. If you have a golden heart and you see something going wrong, the first thing you do is you reach out to the person with a prayer within your heart. Within your heart, say a dua to Allah. Oh Allah, help me and help them. Help me in my own mess and help them in whatever they're going through. You know, that's what it is. So for a person to practice only during Ramadan is not ideal, because what you've done, you've walked through the aisles of the same supermarket and you put all the goods into the trolley and you went to the till. The till depicts the end of Ramadan, right? And the market is the Ramadan and the goods are the good deeds, right? They're being sold. Are you following my example here? And as you're walking, you've taken so much, mashallah, and you know you've just got a bargain. You've just saved thousands of pounds in one trolley. And you've taken the trolley, you have to go to the till, right? The till is either self-help or someone cashes everything out for you. And as they're cashing it out, you need to walk out of that supermarket or store with the goods, not without them. Many of us, we've taken everything and then we leave the whole trolley in the supermarket and we walk out. Hey, I had a bargain. There were bargains at this shop. You just lost your money. You didn't achieve anything. That's what we do with Ramadan. We do the good deeds in the month of Ramadan throughout the month. Everything was collected. We forget to cash out on the day of Eid. And we come out of Ramadan, but where's all the good deeds? Ah, we left them in the store. Allahu Akbar. You see the example I've given you? It is similar to what we do in Ramadan inside out. We read the Quran and outside we don't. We change a bit and outside we don't. We don't carry it through. We don't take those groceries that we bought out into the house and open them out and eat them and enjoy. We've left them in there. That's what we do in Ramadan. So we need to make sure that this time, whatever changes we've effected, we're going to try our best to maximize on the benefit outside of Ramadan. Guess what? someone was asking a question, what's the best way not to dip after Ramadan? Well, to prepare for Hajj. Prepare for Hajj. Make a niyyah. I'm going for Hajj. Right? If you can afford it. Inshallah. You start preparing for Hajj. Or, if you haven't done that, you start preparing for the adhahi, the sacrifice. Wherever it's going to be across the globe, whatever is going to happen and so on, prepare for it. How many of us can afford it, but we don't do it? I promise you. That's why as soon as the moon is sighted, we have two problems. The first thing is, shaitan is released. I'm sure you know that, right? Shaitan is released. And people wonder, how can shaitan be tied up in Ramadan when sin is happening in Ramadan? Agreed? Shaitan is supposed to be tied up, but this is when the men are yelling and the women are, whatever else is happening, anything, and you get angry and people are divorcing and people are committing this and that in terms of sin, and the shaitan's supposed to be tied. Can I tell you what? Those shayateen are tied. We become our own devils. We are shayateen at times. There are so many explanations. One says only the chiefs are tied. The little ones are still running around. And back in Africa, we know the small snakes, when they bite, they are more venomous than the ones that are big. Why? Because the poison is fresh. I'm using simple language. Okay? The serum, that poison, it's actually very new. It's still not diluted in any way. Boop, and you're out in 8 minutes. But if the big one bit you, don't worry, you have 8 hours to get to the hospital. So, with us, possible, those little shayateen. But more than that, we, there are devils from among mankind and from among jinnkind. The Quran says that, min al-jinnati wa nas, right? Shayateen al-jinni wal-ins, right? The Quran speaks about both. Shaytan from mankind and from jinnkind. Sometimes we've already become little devils ourselves. May Allah forgive us. May Allah strengthen us. Ramadan is a month of self-discipline. That's why the hadith keeps saying that, you know what? If you are going to stay away from food and drink, but your attitude is not going to change, you've wasted your time staying away from food and drink. Do you know the hadith? The hadith says, whoever doesn't leave false statements and false witness and vulgar words and abusive words while they are fasting, Allah doesn't need the fact that they stayed away from their food and drink. They wasted their time. That's what the hadith says. Do you know why? You're supposed to develop your character. You're walking down the aisle. If you had swallowed the anger outside Ramadan, you would get a reward. If you swallow the anger in Ramadan, your reward is multiplied 10, 70, 700 and beyond times. So the next time you want to get angry, especially when your fast is, I think, 15, 16, how many hours here in Glasgow? This year? How many? 17 to 19 hours. The sisters say 17 and the brothers say 19. Wow. Somewhere between the two. Whether it's 17 or 19, I hope there's no argument and debate about, oh, I think there is, right? About what time to start and what time to end. Trust me, you do what you believe is right. It's okay. Allah knows. It's fine. It's not a major issue. We've all stopped eating prior to the time, inshallah. Allah make it easy. I don't even want to get into that debate. And there's a reason why. Because it's ijtihad. It's a matter of trial and error. It's a matter of opinion. And no one can say my opinion is over yours, because they both have just tried to achieve something. They've used a method to come to this time, and that's it. It's up to you to look into both and decide which you believe is perhaps better, or if there are scholars you trust, you follow that opinion. When they ask me, I say to them, I have no opinion. I come from Zimbabwe. We don't have the problem. Fly over to us. You can only fast 9 to 12 hours and you're done. And I know people from Europe who fly down to Cape Town for Ramadan, and there's nothing wrong. If you can afford it and you really want to come, there is nothing wrong at all to fly to a place where perhaps the fasting is going to be a little bit easier. People say, but don't be a hypocrite. What hypocrisy? I'm using my money fi sabilillah. Yeah. I'm taking my family, my kids who cannot fast perhaps the long fast, and I'm taking them to a place where at least they can fast. What's the big deal? Subhanallah. I see some of the brothers nodding their heads, mashallah. I hope you're going to take your families out. Alhamdulillah. Allah make it easy.
But that's Ramadan. But what's the point of all of that if you're going to come out of Ramadan? Nothing
really was carried with you. Nothing was carried with you. What's the point?
That's why we say, post Ramadan, there will be a dip. I told you the first bad thing is that shaitan is released. Shaitan is released. The second is that Ramadan is over. Or maybe we can word it the other way. Ramadan is over, shaitan is released. Ramadan is over. Do you know the blessing in Ramadan? Allah blessed the month so much. It is a month where we're not supposed to be eating and drinking, right? But I promise you, go and open the fridge in the month of Ramadan. There is more food than any other month. Have you seen the irony? More food than any other month. In fact, from now we've already prepared for Ramadan in many cases. Am I right? How ironic. Imagine a non-Muslim comes to us and says, you guys are so lucky, you're not going to be eating much. We say, come and see my fridge, man. Yes, wallahi, it's happening. We give so much of importance to food in Ramadan. It's like, gosh, this is the month of eating. I know people who gain weight in Ramadan. Because they think, now that I haven't eaten for 18 hours, the other few hours are for qada. You know, qada is for salah, not for food. If you miss a salah, you make two, yes, or three, you make it up again. You missed a meal, doesn't mean now I need to munch so much. Many of us, as soon as the adhan goes, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, it's like, just a race, right? And that's what Ramadan is all about. And then we get up for Maghrib, and we can't even stand in salah. Because why? You know, you go to ruku and you just say one subhanallah and you're up again because you don't want your belly to be pressed. You go to sujood and you can't manage because it's too low. Reality, that's why you're laughing. Am I right? True. Sorry, I might be slightly guilty there as well. But we should be disciplined. It's not qada. Yes, you enjoy. I promise you, I want to give you another blessing of Allah. You see, go to your fridge tonight. Take out some of those pies or savories or samosas or whatever else might be there, right? Fry them up. And then feed them to the family. Check what it tastes like. Do the same thing the first of Ramadan. And check what it tastes like. Don't you agree with me? The one in Ramadan tastes totally unique. Totally different, right? Completely out of this world. That samosa is like min al-jannah. Allahu Akbar. These things come in. And it's so unhealthy because, to be honest, it's not even a sunnah to open your fast with fries. And that's what we do. I promise you. We are guilty of opening the fast with the most unhealthy food ever to exist. And the hadith says, you know what? Dates, water. So we have a ceremonial attachment to dates and water. Ceremonial means I break my fast. Here's the date. Here's the water. Now where's the samosas? That's how it is. You don't have all these savories. You're in trouble. I know of women, I'm not sure here in Glasgow, but in my part of the world, they start gathering together, you know, making the pastries, helping each other. I made my 12 dozens. You're going to make your 12 dozens, 15 dozens. And you know what? Freezer space in a Muslim home is always a problem. It's a problem. But it's a month of not eating. Inshallah, we can change that. Bi-ithnillah. Make it simple. Simplify it. Eat low GI, as they say. Eat healthy. Have a few grains. Have something that's going to help you. Whatever is suiting to your diet, inshallah. And try and cut out on this. I've done it and it's really helped me a lot. Mashallah. I've cut down on it a lot. A lot, subhanallah. Once in a while, you know, you have a bit of a, you know, a quiet little attack on some of the things that look too good, you know. It's like the little pie is looking at you and saying, oh, have me, you know. And you're like, no. And then you suddenly, may Allah forgive us. My brothers and sisters, why I'm saying this is because Ramadan, as much as it's supposed to be spiritual, there was a sister down there saying, what do I say to my non-Muslim friends who are asking about Ramadan? Trust me, if they were to witness the reality of what goes on in some of our homes, they would wonder whether or not it is actually a month where you're not supposed to be too involved with food and drink. Some people spend the entire night munching away.
I remember last year I spent a few days of Ramadan in the UK. And with all my love and with all my respect to the brothers and sisters, it was my first time having such long fasts. And I led the Taraweeh in London somewhere. Every two rakat, people are just... I'm like, what's going on here, guys? I mean, is the Salaamu Alaikum wa Rahmatullah, is it in order to quickly have something and, you know, say Allahu Akbar once again? And another bad habit some of the brothers have, and I noticed it. You say, Waladdalin, and when you're saying, Ya Alamu, like you're about to go down, then they quickly get up. And before that, they were just munching. Some of the people are doing this. May Allah forgive us. It's a month of ibadah. I tell you what, we want to carry it out of Ramadan as well. If I have lost weight in the month of Ramadan, it shouldn't be my prime intention. But if it happens as a byproduct, if it happens just, you know, because of the fact that it was Ramadan, Alhamdulillah, I must be concerned about my health throughout the month. Keep the fasts going. The Mondays and the Thursdays are sunnah. Wallahi, as I explained, the medical experts who are not Muslim are doing it. They've told you, they're trying. You know, they're practicing upon it and they're promoting it. And we who are Muslims, we were never even too interested in this. Subhanallah. And I can tell you another one. When we exit the month of Ramadan, there are the three fasts of the white days. You know what the white days are? When the moon is white and bright and out. 13th, 14th and 15th of the lunar calendar, the lunar month. It's a sunnah to fast. Why? You will get a reward 10 times. So 3 by 10 is 30. Immediately after Ramadan is a month of Shawwal. The hadith says, whoever fasts Ramadan and follows it up with 6 fasts in Shawwal that do not have to be consecutive, by the way, they don't have to be consecutive, that person will have a reward for having fasted the entire year, because a good deed is multiplied by 10. Remember earlier I said good deeds are multiplied by 10? You fasted 1 month, multiply by 10, equivalent 10 months. You fast 6 days, multiply by 10, 60 days. 60 days is 2 months. 10 months and 2 months, 12 months. My reward, I've achieved it. So it's amazing. It's a reward that we will get. It's a blessing we will achieve. Become dedicated to fasting. You know, how many of you engage in some form of exercise on a regular basis, whether it's in the gym or whether it's a makeshift gym or whether it's at home? Please put up your hands. Uh-oh. We need more, inshallah. Trust me, if you sweat for 45 minutes every single day, your life will change. Did you hear what I said? And I'm not joking. If you sweat every day for 45 minutes, sweat. Don't worry whether it smells or doesn't. Nobody's going to smell it. You're going to have a shower. Okay? If you sweat for 45 minutes every day, you will be a different person in no time. It will help you. It boosts you. It actually helps you in your ibadah as well. It helps you in your acts of worship. And the Prophet ﷺ has encouraged us to have healthy bodies. Many of us burn zero. Nothing. No burning. We only eat. That's it. And we expect it to just on its own. You know, the brother just now, I told him, hey brother, you know the belly. You know, what happened to the six pack? He told me, well, it's now one big family pack. That's what's happening, subhanAllah. Learn to do your leg ups, your sit ups, your press ups, your crunches, your Pilates, whatever else you want. Please take it seriously. I thought there would be more people here who would put up their hands and say, yes, we're there. It's the in thing, guys. Come on. Get it done. Do it within a good environment. I'm not saying compromise your Islam because of the environment, but learn to sweat it out every day, at least 5 to 6 days a week. You will change. If you're feeling sad, depressed, low, it will go by the help of Allah. And it will help you in your salah. The point I was going to raise is how dedicated we are when it comes to our personal health and the way we look. We spend hours on end to look nice. What about hours on end to have a good hereafter? Can't we... That salah we did, that prayer that we had in Ramadan and we so beautifully read that taraweeh, whether it was whatever amount, whatever units we did, but it was more, it was extra and above the farad, wasn't it? Let's carry on after the month of Ramadan and at least fulfill the farad. At least fulfill the farad. Like I was saying, the sister who asked that question about the hijab after Ramadan, try it out inshallah, keep it on. I know of sisters who wear the hijab or who started off every Friday and then they decided, well, we're going to have it every Monday and every Thursday. And then they said, ah, a few more days in the week, just keep it on. Took them a while, but they started off with a step. I want to be the person who encourages you with that step. I don't want to discourage you by saying, hypocrite. You're not a hypocrite. You're just trying. It's your struggle. And trust me, that struggle you know and Allah knows. We all have our own struggles. But I will encourage you strongly to say, you know what? Let's remember the days are numbered. We're not going to live forever. We need to be concerned about the day we're meeting with Allah. Brings me to another thing. The question was asked, what was the last verse to be revealed? Okay, the answer is, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Be conscious of the day that you are ultimately going to return to Allah. That was the last verse that was revealed. Quran. Watch out, be careful, be conscious of the day you are going to go back to your Maker. That was the last verse. That verse actually shakes us because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the entire Quran, Sunnah, the whole deen was complete. And then he says, you know what? Be careful. One day you're coming back to us. Just prepare for that day. I want to ask every one of us, myself included, what have I done? What have we done to prepare ourselves for the day we're going to meet with Allah? Are we becoming better as the days pass or are we becoming worse? If we're becoming better, good news. Good news. If we're getting worse, you have a lot to do. You have a lot to do. May Allah make it easy for all of us. So Allah gives us the season of Ramadan so that we can become clean again. And once you're clean, you don't want to mess your slate again. مَنْ صَامَ رَمَضَانَ إِيمَانًا وَاحْتِسَابًا غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ. Whoever fasts Ramadan with conviction, with iman, with faith, with belief, with hope in the mercy of Allah and the acceptance, we will wipe out all their previous sins. That's what Allah says. The same for the one who actually stands up in prayer at night for the sake of Allah. Don't be lazy. Don't be lazy. Pray for the sake of Allah and take your time. You know, look for the masjid that has the smoothest taraweeh, that actually cools you off, you know, when you stand and you're just like, oh, for the sake of Allah. Because we look for masjids that speed down the road. Even the cameras cannot pick you up. That's how fast you are. We go down into sujood as though we are doing a favor to Allah. Peck. Salah. Allah. What did you just say? Subhanallah. Is that Subhana Rabbi al-A'la? What did you just say? Not once. You're supposed to say it at least thrice. Try. We say, no, one is farad. I heard one is farad. We know one is farad. We're telling you, say it a little bit more. That's your Lord. Come on. That's your Lord. He's going to solve all your problems. That's your Lord. You don't know. He's your Lord. Build your relationship with Him. If He says you can say it thrice, say, no, I'll say it 5 times. It's okay. And I'll learn a few other du'as to read in sujood. I don't want to ask you to raise hands, but I know that most of us don't know any other du'as that can be said in sujood besides Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Am I right? Thank you. You need to learn some other du'as. You've been reading Salah for many, many years. Read another du'a. Pick up the sunnah. Find out what are the other du'as. Let me read another du'a someday. Let me try and invoke in a way the Prophet ﷺ did as well in sujood. So it's amazing. It's a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take your time. You know why? When you take your time in voluntary prayer in the month of Ramadan, outside of Ramadan, when it comes to the compulsory prayer, it will be so easy for you. So easy, mashallah. And if you get used to fasting on a weekly basis, a monthly basis, it's going to be amazing for you. It's going to be beautiful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you goodness in this world and the next. Your health will improve. Everything else improves. You know when Allah says something, trust me, He says in the Quran, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ. we will show them signs in the horizons and within themselves that will prove to them, or until it is proven to them beyond doubt, that the Quran is the truth and the religion of Allah is the truth. Hence, you find scientific discoveries on a regular basis that have at the end come to conform to that which the Quran has revealed. So initially it might not be. You know, the difference is science keeps changing. Today they discover something, 5 years later they discover something opposing that, and it's suddenly forgotten. And 5 years earlier they were laughing at us, right? Because they said, look, this is against the Quran. And when they all died away, someone else discovered, no, hang on, there is something else. Look at the galaxies they're discovering. Look at the black hole that they witnessed not so long back, right? Look at everything else. Take a look at the fasting, this issue, that issue. So many other things. Take a look at the pan that you squat on in order to relieve yourself. And the difference that that has with sitting up as though you're seated on a chair. I'm talking about relieving yourself. That's why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum say, مَا تَرَكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ سَلَّمَ خَيْرًا إِلَّا وَدَلَّنَا عَلَيْهِ وَلَا شَرًّا إِلَّا حَذَّرَنَا مِنْهُ حَتَّى الْخِرَاءَةَ أَوِ الْخُرَاءَةَ. There is no good that the Prophet, peace be upon him, forgot to teach us. And there is no bad that he forgot to warn us about. Even how to relieve yourself. It's an honor. It's an honor to speak about what Islam says about cleaning yourself and tahara and using the toilet and so on. That is probably one of the most defining topics when it comes to Islam. Your cleanliness. Islam teaches you to be clean inside out, upside down. Did you hear that? That's why we say cleanliness is half of your faith. Because even the words that come out of your mouth are supposed to be clean. Are we clean? We're dirty. We say the most abusive words as salt and pepper. Stop it. Do you know what salt and pepper means? I've seen brothers and unfortunately sisters too. As they're talking to you, they add the F's and the B's just by asking you, how are you, man? They say, how, whatever are you? Why did you have to add that there? For what? You just messed everything up. You're a believer. Clean it. How are you? Everything fine. Ooh, lovely to see you. It could have stopped there. You didn't have to add the B's and the F's and the Z's and the R's and the U's and what's the other one? The W and all of those. You must be wondering, I wonder what's that. I don't know either. I just made it up. But that's what people are doing. They're adding all words. And it's funky. You know, it's something, whoa, I'm going to be accepted if I do that. Don't. You're a believer. Allah wants you to be clean. You're clean inside out, upside down. I mean it. Your tongue is clean. Your eyes are clean. You look at that which you're supposed to be. And you're happy and satisfied. And when you're not supposed to be, you know, you bring your eyes to a beautiful confidence of comfort and put it in a zone that Allah knows, and you know, I just achieved the pleasure of my maker. Wow. And you feel so good about yourself. Why? I didn't do it for you, for anyone else. I just did it for my maker. Allah says, if you've done that with your eyes, we will call you on the day of judgment and ask you to choose what gift you'd like. Why? You did something for me. What was stopping you? Nothing. I had a friend of mine visiting from Medina Munawwara 20 years back. He visited us and we took him to Cape Town. And when we were, you know, we were showing him the beach, right? And we're walking. And I didn't notice anything. We don't notice things. Why? Because we're used to everything. And later on the hotel, he says, Sheikh, you people are awliya. And I'm like, where's this heading? You guys are like pious. I said, why? Listen to what he said. And this is why I don't like to judge anyone. He says, haram is dangling in front of you and you don't even notice. And we don't have haram dangling in front of us, but we go out searching for it. Are you looking at the difference? He says, you guys are living in a totally free country and you're still not doing anything wrong. You guys are carrying yourselves very well. He says, I've been watching A lot of the Muslims, they get on with their business. And he says, I couldn't even control my eyes or anything, you know. He says, I'm just like, gosh, I'm struggling here. And this is what he said, when haram is available and you stay away from it, you're a greater saint than the one whom haram is not available and he's staying away from it. Why? You have engaged in an act of worship that he did not have the opportunity to engage in. And that is holding yourself back from something so tempting just for the sake of Allah. What stopped you? Nothing. My maker. When I'm kind to people, when I smile at people, when I help people, male or female, black or white, Muslim or not Muslim, I always remind myself, you're doing this for Allah. And I smile. It makes me so happy. And if they swear me back, and if they look at me funny, and if they say bad words, and if they do, if they react in a negative way, gosh, I got my reward. I'm smiling even more. Subhanallah, I've lost nothing. When I do it for myself or to impress you, I get upset when you're not impressed. But I didn't do it to impress you. I did it to impress Allah. He was already impressed, and he was more impressed when you retaliated in a bad way, and I was still a good guy. And I still carried on. And I still carried your bags for you. Subhanallah. Get my point? That's a Muslim. Ramadan is supposed to take you back to these qualities. Help people. Reach out to people. Be charitable. Assist your neighbors. Go out to the Muslims and the non-Muslims who are in need. And understand they are your brothers and sisters from one mom and dad. And when you're charitable and you reach out to them and they smile and they're so moved by it, that alone was okay. It's fine. It's a deed. It was done in Ramadan. It's multiplied so much, mashallah, tabarakallah. There was one question asked earlier about whether or not zakat should be in the month of Ramadan alone. And the answer was perfect. The answer was perfect. I want to say that sometimes your calculation of zakat happens to coincide with the Ramadan, but prior to Ramadan, there is a need that suddenly came about. We had floods back in Zimbabwe not so long ago. Millions of people are affected by it and still affected by it. I promise you, at the time, it is correct and it was correct and still is correct for you prior to Ramadan to say, oh Allah, as much as I want to wait for Ramadan to give this out, today there is a desperate need for it. I'm giving it out. Give me the reward as though I gave it in the month of Ramadan. He will give it to you because he knows the need was brought in front of you prior to Ramadan. Give it. You follow what I'm saying? If there's a necessity, rise to the occasion. Do something. Give something. How much are you going to take into your grave? But I promise you, going back to the issue of cleanliness, I spoke about how clean a Muslim is supposed to be. Your eyes are clean. Your brain is clean. Your brain, your thoughts should be clean, not dirty thoughts. You shouldn't be having the worst possible thoughts of your brother or your sister when they do something or say something. You know, when you hear someone say something or see them do something, a true Muslim is taught to have the best possible thoughts. For example, you see a brother walking out with perhaps a sister and you know they're not related or you know whatever. You have to think the best of things. Maybe they just met, maybe he's helping, maybe whatever, and mind your business and carry on. But you know what happens today? We are contaminated and diseased. Do you know why? We will never entertain the good thought anymore. Most of us. Because of social media, we love a juicy tale. Juicy. You see the juicy tale. You squeeze the lemon until there are no more drops in there and you're still squeezing. Yes. Because the minute I can expose scandal, I'm going to be famous and popular. That's what it is. Yes, I was the first one to know this. I'm the first one to report this. For what? Couldn't you just keep quiet? And even if someone said something, say, I don't think this is true, you earned a reward. We are taught to defend each other. Defend others. Allah will defend you. Look at the best possible. You know, there is a chance. There is a possibility. You might have a very, very good looking sister who's suddenly in need. And then you find a brother who happens to be there at the time. What do you expect? Sister, can't help you. What are people going to think? We are dying as an ummah because of the statement, what are people going to think? We don't allow our children to marry across the racial line, across the tribal line, across the whatever other line, ethnicity line, because What's my family going to say? What's my brothers going to say? What are those people going to say? Gosh, forget about what people are going to say. Did Allah allow it? Yes, He did. Who are you to disallow it? Did you hear what I just said? If Allah allowed it, why are you disallowing it? For what? Allah's going to question you. No, I'm worried about this guy. Yeah. When they have their things, they're not worried about you. They won't be. And when we go into the hereafter on the day of judgment, nothing's going to be happening there by other people. It's going to be our own. I'm there on my own, answering my own questions. In fact, there's a beautiful verse of the Quran that always keeps me going.
وَلَقَدْ جِئْتُمُونَا فُرَادَا كَمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ.
Allah says, look, you have come to us. You have come to us on this day, the day of judgment, alone, singular, all by yourself, just like the day we made you, just like the day we created you. Here today, you are alone. You're coming here to defend yourself. One, singular, no one's with you.
وَمَا نَرَى مَعَكُمْ شُفَعَاءَكُمْ.
Allah says, in fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَتَرَكْتُمْ مَا خَوَّلْنَاكُمْ وَرَاءَ ظُهُورِكُمْ.
Everything and everyone that we gave you to be around you, to give you the comfort and to prop you up, you've left them behind. Where are they? There's no one. Your wealth is not there, your power is not there, your position is not there, your looks is not there, your looks are not there, nothing is there. Allah says, where's everything we gave you? Not here today. It's just you and it's just us. And we're taking account of your deeds. Where's everyone? And Allah says, where are those intercessors you were claiming would intercede on your behalf? Where are they? Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the intercession of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Say Ameen. Definitely, Allah has blessed him and granted him a position that is higher than everybody else's. So he will definitely have that capacity within what Allah has allowed to intercede on behalf of the sinful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us from that intercession. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, I've just been told that I have run out of time. But I don't think it's fair. I really don't think it's fair. I landed here this afternoon. And as we landed, the plane broke down on the runway. And the captain announced some minutes later that, you know what, the front wheel, something snapped and it's not moving anymore. It's not turning around. It's not turning. So we had to wait for someone to come in. It's like I was being tested. Are you going to make it in time? I was supposed to be here much earlier, by the way. I delivered a talk this morning that finished at about 11:30 in Milton Keynes. And I drove myself to Heathrow, subhanAllah. And I flew over to Glasgow. And then this happens to the plane, subhanAllah. And you know what? It took them 15, 20 minutes and we got finally to the bay. And when I got off, my bags just didn't come out. Subhanallah. It's like saying, you're preaching this peace, this tolerance, this goodness. What about you? We're going to test you. We're going to dangle this. Wallahi, I was just smiling. And I was saying, oh Allah, you don't want me to go. I'm not going to go. It's okay. It's fine. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. Suddenly my bag popped up. Oh, I think you still want me to go. Okay. MashaAllah. And then guess what happens? Got the bags. Walking out. Message the brother. He says, walk straight out, you see me. When I walk straight out, I see buses, I see taxis. I can't see the brother. He says, a blue car. A blue car. I'm looking, I can't see the blue car. I say, brother, this is ridiculous, man. Anyway, no, come to the pickup area. Okay. Looking now, pickup, pickup. Pickup says, pickup one, pickup two. I said, okay, what do I do? I said, okay, let me try pickup two. Not my day. Pickup two says A, B, C, D, O, E. I promise you, I'm not lying, right? I say, now, which way should I go? So suddenly, I decided, let me take A. I'm walking towards A. I phone the brother again. He says, no, 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 no. I'm at pickup one. I said, oh, no. Now I turn around, walking all the way back. I say, oh, Allah, you know what? You still don't want me to get there? I won't get there. Subhanallah. And then I walk towards pickup one and I see the brother. Then my bag doesn't go into his boot. And then he has to take some things out of there and put them in the back seat. And then it goes in. And then we're coming around here. I was supposed to have been here at 4. Earlier than that, actually. But subhanAllah, we made it. And that's why when he said 2 minutes, I'm like, gosh, if you know what I did to get here, you wouldn't say just 2 minutes, Habibi. Look, he's smiling now. He's smiling. You know why he's smiling? He knows that I can go on and on. The podium is mine right now. But we thank Allah. I really, and I came here and I'm sitting and I was so tired. And the first lecture I delivered was Salatul Fajr and immediately after Fajr. And thereafter there was a retreat happening somewhere in Milton Keynes. Our Nigerian brothers and sisters had a massive, beautiful family retreat there that I participated in. So I was in Northampton last night. And this morning we had this. And then I had a second lecture, and that's when I came here. And I've given you the rest of it. But in the last 2 weeks, I think I must have visited 14 different cities across the globe. So you have to really make dua for all of us. I'm just here to motivate myself. Actually, that's true. I'm here to motivate myself. Because wallahi, when I was seated here, and I thought, these brothers and sisters, gosh, they're sitting here. I opened the book. Did you see me opening the book? They're sitting here from 12. From 12. God, I better start smiling. Mine's not so bad, man. And I'm like, God, alhamdulillah, mashallah. You guys did a good job. May Allah bless you. Next time, I think we shorten it a little bit. What do you say? Shorten it a bit, right? Inshallah, yeah. Some are saying no. Some are saying, lengthen it? No, I think shorten it a little bit. Perhaps we'll modify it slightly. May Allah make it easy. If you have good feedback, you can always give it to us, inshallah. If you have good feedback, and even if you have bad feedback, give it to us. But encourage others to participate. You see, I want to end off with one thing. My brothers and sisters, when you come physically, there is a different blessing that you achieve. Allah wants you to gather once in a while as an ummah. You meet people, you interact, you get an opportunity to smile at others, to help them, to reach out to them, to ask them beautiful questions. When I say beautiful questions, I mean, you know, how are you, what's happening, oh, so lovely to see you, etc. Those are beautiful questions. The minute you get a little bit too deep, you become personal, you chase people away. So you ask encouraging questions, and this is the ummah meeting. This interaction is priceless. The blessings we receive and the descending of the blessings is amazing. So don't just think, I'm going to sit at home and watch it online. Make an effort to come. And guess what? If you bring along with you 10 of your friends, even if one of them were to be guided by a millimeter, it's the best thing that has ever happened for you and to you perhaps. Maybe even in your life. Because if Allah guides someone else through your effort, what was your effort? I just said, come, let's go. Come, let's all go. We'll go and we'll enjoy, etc. You know what? Allah will bless you in a billion ways. You don't even know. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. I see the brothers are getting a bit edgy there. I better just close before. Oh, he says it's okay. I can go ahead? All right, guys, we've got more time. But now I think I shouldn't. So now I'm doing it voluntarily, just myself. And you can see that my love for the people of Glasgow is so much, I don't even want to leave the podium. Right? But inshallah, we have a beautiful month of Ramadan. Please prepare. Not just the savory side of it, but please prepare, inshallah, with the Quran and so on. And whatever you do in the month of Ramadan, keep it going after the month, at least a little portion of it. This morning I spoke about how important it is to actually read a verse a day. A verse a day. Doesn't cost you much. One verse a day. How many? One. One verse a day. We ready? One verse a day. You ready to do that? Glasgow. One verse a day. You ready? Yes. MashaAllah. That yes is written. Your name's written. Not by me. It's written here already. Make sure that you follow through on that one, inshallah. May Allah bless you all. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.